Hello, Bea here, and welcome back to Biology and our unit on cells. Today, we are going to look at some of the simplest types of cells. That's what you see here in these pictures. Any idea what type of cells these are? Are they from a bat, a snake, a houseplant, an alien from another planet? Something else. Write down your guess in your PDF notes. I'll give you a hint. These cells are classified as prokaryotic cells. These types of cells have been around for over 3 billion years. They are rather simple in structure and very small. We'll look at just how small later in this lesson. And they are unicellular. Did you guess what they are? Before I give away the answer, let's look at our goals for today. We will describe the main parts of prokaryotic cells and give examples of common types of prokaryotic cells. Did you make your guess? These are all types of bacteria. Bacteria cells are a type of cell called a prokaryote. They are all unicellular and very tiny. Some bacteria can make us sick, but some are actually helpful to us. We'll look at some examples of both as we go through the lesson. We've already talked quite a bit about cells and pointed out that living things are made of cells. But what exactly is a cell? To answer that, let's look at some of the individual parts of a simple cell, like the prokaryotic bacteria cell we saw before. We'll start inside the cell. The big clump of purple stuff in the diagram is the DNA, which clumps together in a region called the nucleoid. There is often a separate piece of DNA called the plasmid as well. This is the cell's genetic material. We can think of this as being like the blueprints for the cell. It contains all of the instructions that allow the cell to build itself and function. The other noticeable structures inside the cell are the ribosomes. These look like tiny dots, but think of each dot as a little factory. And we know that factories make things. So what do the ribosomes make? They make proteins. That was one of the macromolecules you learned about in Unit 2. Without proteins, the cell wouldn't survive, so these factories are very important. The empty space inside the cell is filled with a jelly-like substance called cytoplasm. It's a little like the water in a water balloon. It's actually about 80% water. The rest is various nutrients, enzymes, and compounds. We said earlier that prokaryotic cells are quite simple. The insides are mostly just DNA, ribosomes, and cytoplasm. The cells we'll look at next time have lots more going on inside. However, prokaryotic cells look much more complicated on the outside. In the diagram, notice that the outside of the cell is made of three distinct layers. The innermost layer is the cell membrane, also called the plasma membrane. We'll talk about the structure of the cell membrane in a later lesson, but for now, know that it's a double layer of lipids, another one of those macromolecules from Unit 2, and that its main job is to control what gets in and out of the cell. Think of it like the gatekeeper. Outside the cell membrane, the next layer of protection is the cell wall. This is a rigid layer that gives support to the cell and helps it maintain its shape. But we're not done yet! There is a third layer outside the cell wall called the capsule. This layer tends to be sticky and helps the cell attach itself to surfaces, which is exactly why you should scrub your hands really well when you wash. Just imagine you are trying to get that off. The last structures we'll look at are on the very outside of a prokaryotic cell. They include the flagella, which is a long tail-like piece that allows the cell to move. It looks a bit like a fish swimming through water. So cute! You'll also notice the smaller hair-like pieces all over the cell. These are pili and help the cell attach to surfaces and sometimes exchange genetic material with another cell. Remember that all living things can be grouped into one of three domains: bacteria, archaea, and eukarya. Two of these domains have only prokaryotic organisms, bacteria and archaea. Sometimes they are collectively referred to as monerins. Actually, funny story, scientists didn't recognize the difference between bacteria and archaea for a very long time, and initially grouped them together into one kingdom, called Monera, and the name sort of stuck. Even though they are now known to be two very different domains. Pause the video for a moment to fill out the missing information on the diagram in your notes. We'll start with the bacteria domain, as you may be familiar with some of these organisms already. Any ideas where we might find some bacteria? We would almost certainly find some here. Yep, digging in the dirt. Some common bacteria found in soil are Bacillus and Arthrobacter. Lactobacillus is a bacteria used in making yogurt. Yum! Thanks, bacteria! What about here? On me! Do I have bacteria on me right now? If I could see my skin under a microscope, it would look like a whole ecosystem full of bacteria. Is that gross? Actually, it's not gross at all. In fact, it's a very good thing. These Staphylococcus bacteria live in sweaty places on your skin, like armpits, and are actually responsible for producing the chemical that we associate with body odor. Okay, maybe that's a little gross, but they have another job too. They protect us from other, more harmful bacteria, and there is evidence that they even help dampen inflammation from autoimmune diseases. Some Staphylococcus bacteria can be dangerous if it gets inside our bloodstream, even if it's harmless on the surface of our skin. That's why it's so important to carefully clean and disinfect any cuts or scrapes. Those little buggers will slip in there any chance they get. Of course, you're probably most familiar with the types of bacteria that can make us sick. Have you ever had strep throat? It's the worst, and yep, caused by the bacteria Streptococcus. Other bacteria, like E. coli, can make us sick to our stomach. When bacteria make us sick, it's because they give off chemicals that are toxins and damage nearby tissues. Fortunately, most bacterial infections can now be treated with antibiotics. But what about the other domain of prokaryotes, archaea? We tend to be less familiar with these organisms, and for good reason. Archaea are best known for existing in some of the weirdest places on the planet. Archaea, like the sulfolobus, can be found in sulfur-laden hot springs, surviving in temperatures up to 230 degrees Fahrenheit. I wouldn't last a minute there! In the frigid waters of the Arctic, some archaeota are often found in areas well below freezing. Opposite problem, but nope, wouldn't last there either. In the Dead Sea, its name coming from the fact that it's too salty for almost anything to survive, the halophiles thrive. Salty water, yuck, no way for me! Archaea are so weird that they are often called extremophiles because they can live in such extreme environments. But sometimes their environment isn't weird at all. In fact, you have archaea living inside you right now, like methanogens that live in your digestive tract and help digest your food, and other archaea that help maintain a healthy biome right on your skin. It's okay, they're nice. Don't be grossed out. Of the three domains, archaea are most closely related to the first organisms on Earth. In fact, the word archaea comes from the Greek word meaning ancient things. Although archaea may seem almost alien, humans and other animals are more closely related to archaea than bacteria. We share many genes and protein folding sequences with these cells. Hi, cousins! Well, we've talked about the different parts of a prokaryotic cell and looked at lots of examples. But what is a prokaryotic cell made of? I'll give you a hint. In the last unit, you learned that every piece of matter was made of something. Do you remember the word? Atoms, of course! And molecules, which are multiple atoms bonded together. The most common elements in cells are carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. And remember the specific macromolecules that were made out of those elements? Carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids. Those are the molecules that make up prokaryotic cells, or any cells for that matter. Pause the video here if you need to catch up and write these into your notes. We said in the beginning that prokaryotic cells are tiny. Just how tiny? An average prokaryotic cell measures about 1 micrometer across. That's 1/1000th of a millimeter. Imagine taking those little tiny lines you see on rulers and lining up 1,000 cells in between each pair. That's why we couldn't see them before microscopes were invented. But if their size seems unbelievably small, this number will seem unimaginably big. Even as tiny as they are, prokaryotic cells still contain billions of atoms, because atoms are simply that much smaller. Now that you've had a tour of prokaryotic cells, let's review what we have learned. We described the main parts of a prokaryotic cell, and we gave examples of common types of prokaryotic cells. I have a parting question for you. What kind of cells make up humans? Do you think they are similar to the cells we saw today, or very different? We'll find out next time. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey. See you next time.